Good morning. Please join me in our call to worship. Where does it hurt? We gather this morning with listening hearts to hear the voices of our children. What do you hope? We gather this morning with listening hearts to hear the hopes of children and to nurture the hope within each of us. How can we help? We gather this morning with listening hearts to hear how we can help in partnership with those who are hurting as ones who are hoping. Who are you and why are you here? We gather this morning as God's people to worship God, in confidence that God hears our hurts and hopes before they are even on our lips, and calls us as God's partners to help with a passion for justice and hearts full of love. Come, let us worship God on this children's Sabbath day. Please join me in our unison prayer. O God, help us to recover our hope for our children's sake. Help us to recover our courage for our children's sake. Help us to recover our discipline for our children's sake. Help us to recover our ability to work together for our children's sake. Help us to recover our values for our children's sake. Help us to recover a spirit of sacrifice for our children's sake. Help us to recover our faith in thee for our children's sake. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome, everyone. If you have not done so already, I invite you to light a candle in your at-home worship space. Setting my candle on my green candle mat, I am reminded that in this liturgical season of ordinary time, green means grow. Today, we are growing in our understanding of what it means to echo the words and actions of Jesus to care for children. In 2013, our church adopted a safe church policy, outlining thoughts, ideas, and procedures about how to keep children and vulnerable adults safe as they participate in activities sponsored by our church. Over the years, we have held several trainings for how to reduce the risk of abuse to the children we love, support, and care for. Had many conversations about how to be the safest place possible, and developed a robust Our Whole Lives program, teaching comprehensive, inclusive, and age-appropriate sexuality education that promotes the values of self-worth, sexual health, responsibility, and justice and inclusivity. The day in 2013 when we voted as a congregation to adopt a safe church policy, Roger said to me that eventually safe church would be more than just a policy on paper, that it would become part of the fabric of who we are, woven into our community. I loved that image, and I love how he was right. Bit by bit, we continue to learn more about what it means to be a safe church. And bit by bit, we continue weaving it into all the ministries of this church. During these times of COVID and pandemic, those priorities of safety for our children have influenced decisions made by me, Roger, and by the Safe Return to Church Task Force. As we continue to live into how to be accessible, inclusive, and safe for all members of our church, including our children. We found early on that Zoom made it really accessible for our families with infants and toddlers to attend worship from home. And Zoom Sunday School lets our younger kiddos be comfy in their pajamas and with their own toys while learning and laughing together. We learned more about internet safety, how to prevent Zoom bombing, offering compassion when folks don't feel comfortable turning on their camera, copyright laws, media release forms, and so much more. Our youth have enjoyed being creative at ways to play games online and also gathering together masked and distanced in small groups. Outdoor worship, while the weather permitted it, was accessible in new and different ways for all ages. Our families and households appreciate not being left out of worship or other church events that would not be safe for children. As case counts in Midland County continue to rise without peak, and our local hospitals and medical facilities are stretched almost to capacity, and as we wait for the option to vaccinate those who are 11 and under, your commitment to being patient, to return to inside worship, and protecting those who are vulnerable is commendable. Safe church is more than background checks and webinars about abuse prevention. Safe church is a cumulative effect of all the conversations that take place and the opportunities we share. It's how we embody the call of Jesus to allow us to better care for all the people in our midst. The more we talk and learn about how to be safe and be a safe place for each other, the safer this community becomes. The more it becomes woven into the fabric of this community. Safe church is a proactive approach to being aware of ways that we can be the best stewards of and for each other. Today, my challenge for you is, what more might you be willing to learn to help you to be more open, more affirming, more willing to give physical safety, mental and emotional security, and spiritual encouragement to others as Jesus calls us to? And might you be willing to take that message outside this church community? Maybe it's learning about accessibility, inclusion, and safety, or lack thereof, in our local schools. Maybe it's learning more about the work of local organizations like Safe and Sound and Shelter House, who provide resources and respite for children. Maybe it's learning new inclusive language like pronouns and non-binary terms. Maybe it's reading more about the Children's Defense Fund, who supports this Children's Sabbath Day of Awareness. We know without a doubt that this church is not a building. The church has not been closed for the last 20 months. Church has been innovative, inspiring, expanding, and empowering us all to find God wherever we find ourselves. Thank you for your continued contemplation of how to echo the words and actions of Jesus to continue to care for and give voice to children and young people.
Can you hear the prayer of the children on bended knee in the shadow of an unknown room? Empty eyes with no more tears to cry, turning heaven toward the light, cry, Jesus, help me to see the morning light of one more day. But if I should die before I wake, I pray my soul to take. Can you feel the hearts of the children aching for home, for something of their very own? Reaching hands with nothing to hold on to, but hope for a better day, a better day. Crying, Jesus, help me to feel the love again in my own land. But if unknown roads lead away from home, give me loving arms away from home. Silence. lost in the shattered world. Angry guns preach a gospel full of hate, blood of the innocent on their hands, crying, Jesus, help me to feel the sun again upon my face. For when darkness clears, I know you're near, bringing peace again. Dali chuyete, svediece molitve. Can you hear the prayer of the children?
Here is our first reading from Job chapter 38. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind, "Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up your loins like a man, I will question you, and you shall declare to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone when the morning stars sang together and all the heavenly beings shouted for joy? When the dust runs into a mass and the clods cling together, can you hunt the prey for the lion? Or satisfy the appetite of the young lions when they crouch in their dens or lie in wait in their covert? Who provides for the raven its prey when its young ones cry to God and wander about for lack of food?"
We now turn to the Gospel according to Mark, the 10th chapter, verses 35 through 45. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to Jesus, and they said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask." Jesus said to them, "What is it you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink or be baptized by the baptism that I am baptized with?" They replied, "We are able." Then Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink, and with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or to my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it is prepared." When the 10 other disciples heard this, they became angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and he said to them, "You know among the Gentiles those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. But whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life for a ransom for many." So ends our readings for this day. If you've ever spent time with children, you know that minor injuries are a very common occurrence. scraped knees and bumped elbows are something that happen every day in backyards and on playgrounds and living rooms. In many cases, children are comforted by receiving a kiss to the spot of the boo-boo or on the top of the head. At other times, a Band-Aid can take away the tears very quickly. While quick kisses and Band-Aids often help to ease the hurt of a minor injury, there are hurts that require a much different response. The theme of this year's Children's Sabbath raises the question, where does it hurt? Where does it hurt? This theme encourages us to reflect on the ways in which children in the United States are hurting. This in no way is to diminish the hurt experienced by children in other parts of the world. Some of the ways that children are hurting can be found in the State of America's Children 2021, a report that is produced by the Children's Defense Fund each year. This report is based on information that has been gathered over the past few years, but is relevant to the time period that we're living in. In 2019, there were 73 million children living in the United States, making up 22% of the nation's population. Nearly one in seven children were poor, with nearly 71% of those living in poverty being children of color. More than 1.5 million children enrolled in public schools experienced homelessness during the 2017-18 school year. More than one in seven children, or 10.7 million children, were food insecure. That means that they lived in a household where there wasn't enough food to feed everyone. Black and Hispanic children were twice as likely to live in food insecure households as white children. An estimated 4.4 million children under age 19 were underinsured. The rates of uninsured children are especially high among Hispanic children, undocumented children, children living in the South, and children and families with lower incomes. The high cost of childcare and the lack of early childhood investments has left many children without quality care during the critical years of brain development. Racial and socioeconomic segregation continues to perpetuate achievement gaps in our public school systems. During the 2017-18 school year, 19% of Black, 21% of Hispanic, and more than 26% of American Indian, Alaska Native public school students did not graduate on time, compared with only 11% of white students. A disproportionate number of children of color are incarcerated in the juvenile justice system and/or the adult criminal justice system, placing them at risk of physical and psychological harm. A child or teen in our nation is arrested every 59 seconds. Black youth represent less than 15% of the total youth population, but 52% of youth prosecuted in adult criminal court. Gun violence was the leading cause of death for children and teens ages 1 through 19 in 2018, surpassing motor vehicle accidents for the first time. In 2019, a child or teen was killed with guns every 2 hours and 36 seconds. Family separation and anti-immigration policies are dangerous to children's health, development, and well-being. For the past 2 years, many children have been hurt by the COVID-19 pandemic. They have experienced loneliness, despair, depression, anxiety, and fear. Some have experienced sickness, and a report that I saw just yesterday points out that 170,000 children in our nation alone have lost a parent or caregiver due to COVID. My friends, these statistics highlight some of the larger issues facing our children in our nation. There are many other factors, as you're aware, that are causing our children to hurt. While the amount of hurt being experienced by children is overwhelming and may lead us to believe that there's nothing that we can do to alleviate it, our faith invites us to respond with deep compassion. You might recall in the passage I read from Mark, James, and John come to Jesus asking to become great. Most likely they're thinking in terms of worldly standards in which greatness is associated with those who have power and authority over other people. Jesus responds to their request by teaching that whoever wants to be great must be servant of all. True greatness is found in the person who cares for the most vulnerable people in society, including the children. Jesus makes it perfectly clear that such care is not without suffering. As he has shown, it often puts you at odds with those who do hold positions of earthly power. No, we can't fix all of the problems facing children, but we can, as individuals and as this beloved church, do our part in helping to alleviate some of the hurt. And so I encourage each of us to commit to doing at least one thing in the coming weeks to respond to the hurt that is being experienced by children. This can involve taking the time to learn more about the issues that young people are dealing with. We could do this by reading articles, visiting the Children's Defense Fund website, or actually communicating directly with a child or teen. We could send a note of encouragement to a child or teen who we know. This may be someone in our family, or a neighbor, or someone in this church. Children and youth are strengthened by the support of adults. We can send a note of encouragement to the adults who are working with children and youth. Teachers, social workers, counselors, and church youth workers are dealing with enormous stress these days as they are navigating what it means to help the young people who are experiencing depression and anxiety. We can check in with parents and other caregivers to see if there's any way that we could be of support. We can continue to contribute financially to organizations that are working to help children, remembering that many of the benevolences of our church, including the Pastor's Emergency Fund, supports the needs of children. We can advocate for children by encouraging lawmakers to enact legislation that helps bring children out of poverty, provides nutrition, education, and medical care. As the folks at the Children's Defense Fund state, the service that we are called to do is not only to reach out with a touch of love, but also to change the structures and the systems that are hurting children. When children are the poorest group of Americans, when more than 10 million children are poor, there is a need for change to our nation's structures and systems. When nearly 4.4 million children do not have health care, there is a need for change and for justice on a broader scale. When the odds are stacked against our nation's Black, Latino, and poor children, shunting so many of them into the pipeline of prison, we need to change that system that works against their success and positive futures. Into this work for justice, they say, we take the gospel's teaching on suffering, for in the words of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., human progress is neither automatic nor inevitable. Every step toward the goal of justice requires sacrifice, suffering, and struggle. The tireless exertions and passionate concern of dedicated individuals. Last but not least, another way to reach out to those who are hurting is to include children and youth in our prayers. In doing so, we seek God's guidance as we respond to the question, where does it hurt? May our combined efforts help to ease some of that hurt. Amen.
Hi, I'm Pam Buchholz, a retired United Methodist minister, and now grateful to be part of this United Church of Christ. It was Easter Sunday of 2016 that I first came to worship here at UCC. I came longing for a place of extravagant welcome, and what I heard and experienced on that Sunday was just that. I can't remember the exact words of the message, but I know the heart of it was that there was new life and transformation for each of us, whoever we are and wherever we are on our spiritual journey. Our stewardship theme is rooted in love. I am an active member of this congregation because it is indeed a congregation rooted in love. Love for one another, love for the world, and love for God in all the different ways we understand and experience God. I was a recipient of that love when I experienced a sacral fracture in January 2020, sending me into a spiral of pain and depression. What kept me going were the people and ministries of this church. I received cards from people whose names I barely recognized. They didn't know me personally, but they knew I was hurting. I received home visits and meals. Then as the pandemic hit, the church leadership quickly shifted to online offerings, and I was able to attend worship and Bible study and book study that would not have been possible otherwise. Those connections opened a window to let the light shine back into my soul. If you've not been part of a study group here, I hope sometime you'll find the opportunity. Though the participants are seldom of one mind, rooted in love, we are able to hear one another, learn from one another, and accept one another. Because of the love shown to me by each of you, I've been inspired to be a better neighbor and friend to others. The varied studies of this church help me grow in knowledge and understanding and encourage me to be a stronger advocate for justice issues. This congregation of the United Church of Christ is indeed rooted in love and bearing fruit. I am privileged to join in its ministries through my presence, my gifts, and my service, and I invite you to do the same. Thanks.
I invite you now to join with me in a time of prayer. O God, who hears the cries of all who are hurting, we pray for the church in all its many locations that we may continue to be your hands of help, your voice of justice, and your heart of compassion when it comes to addressing the needs of children. We pray, O God, for the communities we live in, asking that you would guide us to listen to the voices of the young who are hurting, stand with families who are struggling, and work together for healing and the prevention of harm. We pray for our nation and our leaders that they may show courage and compassion for the young who are impoverished, imprisoned, excluded, and vulnerable. We pray for the greater world that is struggling with disease, poverty, war, and climate change, that our love and our action will not be confined by human-made borders. We pray for children near and far who are thriving and those who are struggling, those who are supported and those who are in need of more nurture. We pray for families who have grown together and those who are hurting in broken places. We pray for all who suffer from the COVID-19 pandemic, from unheard and unhealed trauma, from depression and despair, from causes we could have prevented and those we were helpless to heal. Dear God, it is with these and other concerns that we now enter into a time of silent prayer. Most gracious God, we add to our silent prayers our prayers for David and Carol. May your loving spirit continue to uphold them, comfort them, and give them strength. Compassionate God, we offer all of our prayers in the spirit of the one who demonstrated the power of serving others, Jesus, the one we call the Christ. Together we offer the prayer that Jesus once shared with his original disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now let us go forth from this time of worship with the love of God, the compassion of Christ, and the sustaining power of the Holy Spirit. Go in God's peace. Amen.
Bless the beasts and the children. For in this world they have no voice, they have no choice. Bless the beasts and the children.
The children.